Good morning, everyone. Welcome to this, the fourth meeting of the Welfare Reform Committee in 2014. Could everyone please make sure that their mobile phones and other electronic devices are switched off? Our first agenda item is to take a decision on whether to have item four on today's agenda, consideration of the evidence we will receive today on food banks in private. Members of the committee agreed that we take that item in private? Okay. Thanks very much. That brings us to item two, which is our evidence session on the issue of food banks and whether there are possible links to the UK Government's welfare reforms. Individual members of the committee have themselves been visiting food banks in their local areas to inform our evidence session this morning. Later on, we'll have a second panel of witnesses who are the authors of the report, The Overview of Food Aid Provision in Scotland. But firstly, I'd like to welcome our roundtable witnesses, and they are Mary Hayes, the Operations Director, West of Scotland, British Red Cross, Caroline Alcorn, Interim CEO, Edinburgh Cyrerians, FareShare Edinburgh, Dave Simmers, Chief Executive, Community Food Initiatives North East, Denis Curran, Chairman of Loaves and Fishes, Joe Roberts, Development Lead, Community Food Moray, and Ewan Gurr, Scotland Development Officer at the Trussell Trust. And for transparency, I've been working in support of Ewan Gurr's efforts in North and South Lanarkshire to establish food banks on behalf of the Trussell Trust there. But the roundtable format enables members of the committee to ask questions directly of the witnesses, but I hope that it's more of an interaction. We try and keep it structured, but as informal as possible. So if you want to make a comment or ask a question, just give me an indication and we'll keep the discussion flowing as long as we can. So hopefully everyone will get an opportunity to help inform us, tell us what you're doing, what your experiences are. But equally, if you've got suggestions as to what the committee could take forward from this discussion, then please make suggestions as well. Don't think you're just here to give us information. Signpost us in the direction that you think we need to go. In order to kick things off, I think the deputy convener wanted to ask a question or make an observation, and then I'll just open up to anyone. It doesn't have to be in any particular order. Just if you feel you want to make a contribution, just let me know.
Thank you, convener. It's a question rather than an observation. Although it is informed by an observation, I have observed that the UK government has made a number of statements related to the increased use of food banks. They refute that there is any direct correlation between their welfare reform process and the increased utilisation of food banks in Scotland and across the rest of the United Kingdom. Indeed, I understand that one of their ministers even wrote to Glasgow City Council at one stage and suggested that the more efficient use of food by supermarkets, the disposal of food, might be a driver in the growth of food banks. So how would you respond to the UK government saying that there's no correlation between their welfare reform process and maybe even the particular point they made about supermarkets' food efficiency being a driver in the growth in the number of food banks? That's just an open question to everyone. I don't know who'd like to respond first.
I suppose I can only speak from my own experience, but having read some of the evidence from other people, I think it's very clear in our experiences that welfare reform certainly has had an impact on the increase in our use of the food bank, and we personally in Moray don't use any surplus food from supermarkets anyway in our food bank. And that's really.
Alan?
I think looking at it as representing FareShare in Scotland and Cyrerians, which work in the field of homelessness and social exclusion, certainly access to our homeless prevention service and the need for emergency food packs have increased because people have less money in their pocket, basically. So it's rise in rents, rise in food costs, rise in fuel costs, and income not rising alongside it. But I think it's deeper than that. For us, it's you know, there is a problem and people need food, but we need to get why they need food and solve it at a different level. I think that's the big thing, that we're putting a bit of an elastoplast on and not getting to the root of the problem. But certainly there is a total increase in the number of people. We are doubling the number of emergency food packs, which are well managed through ensuring that it's not just a food pack, but the support that goes with it. So why is there a problem and what do we need to do to resolve it?
I think you made an interesting comment when you said that people's incomes had not kept up or had decreased. Now, that's the perception that I've picked up, is that people think that those who are going to food banks are unemployed people. They are people who have no income. You're clearly saying there that this is having an impact on people who are working, have an income, but aren't able to meet the demands of increases elsewhere, is that right?
Yeah, absolutely. And it's not, I mean, I'd like to make it clear that FareShare is not a food bank, and that's not our business. Our business is in seeing that surplus, good quality, within date, checked for condition, and to see that it is absolutely right, it's the same food as you would eat at home and I would eat at home, goes to the right place. So for us, it's dealing with hostels, it's dealing with soup kitchens, it's dealing with projects who have got reduced budgets, who are finding that they are having more people who are homeless or at risk of being homeless access their services. So for us, it's about that as well. You know, that's a big growth area. And somehow I think that knowledge is being diminished because there is, rightly so, a big drive with food banks, but we're forgetting the people that are the hidden people below that. And often that's going to be the people that are accessing food banks today that are becoming the people that are in hostels tomorrow. So it's a wider picture.
Yeah. Denis, you want to?
Well, my experience of Loaves and Fishes, we're a totally voluntary group. We get no government funding whatsoever. We're totally dependent on people's goodwill. Now, I've had a couple of stores approach me, and the food they want to offer me is bash tins and stuff that's kind of out of date. And when I tell them we don't use it, they look at me, you know. You don't use it? I say, well, very simply. When my wife comes into your store, she doesn't say, where's your aisle for the bash tins and where's your aisle for the out-of-date stuff? People are coming to us. Now, we're in the middle of no man's land. And we've got people coming, wee bits of children, and they're walking 3 and 4 miles. And there seems to be a fallacy going out that it's misused, it's greed. These people have their layabouts, their rogues. They're people that's in total dismay. They're frightened, they're insecure. They've no money. We got a phone call just the other day, there, for the social work department. Can you give us food for a family that they don't need to cook because they've no money for their electricity? You know, so it's, the picture that the government's painting is a totally, totally wrong picture. Yep. People are coming here, they come to us. Last night, we were in at Redfield St Stephen's, we do a meal there. When the lads came, he sent for a job, done 2 hours' work, and he even brushed the floor up when he's finished. He wasn't asked to do, but he'd done it. And the manager asked him down and says to him, no, you're not suitable. And he never got a penny for his 2 hours' work. That's immoral. When these things happen in this 2014, these things are immoral. For somebody to do anything, whether labour is worthy or not, if they've went there and they've done the best that they could and they're maybe not suitable, they're still entitled to the payment that they're put in for that job. Yeah. I don't think anybody in here would be toiling away through here next week if they want to get in time for their day's labour the day, eh? And this is happening all the time. Yeah. The amount of people that comes to us, it's sanctioned. It's unbelievable. A man that comes, he's been sanctioned for 11 weeks. And that's 11 weeks without any money. Oh, it's misused, they're coming back to you. Of course they're coming back to us. If you have no money this week and you're not getting any money next week, how are you going to feed yourself? We've got a lady that hadn't yet for 3 days because she was feeding her children. The Easter eggs get buried under the table. They don't come to light. It's easier to say, or their thieves, liars, cheats and layabouts. They misuse their benefit systems. The benefit systems are based in the national poverty line. Who are the companies that's paying below the national poverty line? Name them and shame them. Who are the companies that's not paying their inland revenue? Now, when the government brought this out, they had a meeting on a Thursday. They made a decision on the Thursday to change the benefit system. And the Tuesday, it was made law. Fact. At the same time, we're talking about looking at these companies that's not paying their proper tax. We're still looking at these people not paying their proper tax. It's the most simplest thing in the world to solve. You're the managing director of this company, and we reckon you owe that tax, you have not paid it. Not to pay your tax is unlawful. If it's not paid by the end of next month, you and you's gone to jail. Because that's basically what you're doing to the people that's going for benefits. You're not getting it. I don't think you're worthy of payment. That's what that's saying. So what is it we're going to do with it? 2014 and people can't eat.
Yeah. Dave?
Did I do press? Oh, goodness me, it's automatic. Dave Summers, Community Food Initiative North East. We have the FareShare franchise up in the North East, but we've also, over the last year, been running our own food bank. To go back to the original question, anecdotally, we've got strong evidence of the impact of welfare reform on the usage of food banks, but I think undoubtedly there's a need to back that up with independent research. I'm delighted those two institutions, RGU and the Rowett Institute, have approached us about being involved in some independent research over the use of the food bank, which I think we need to back up the anecdotal stuff. It is important, I think, as Mr. Curran was saying, folk who've been awarded benefit, but it's taken 4, 5, 6 weeks for the money to come through, clearly they're in a bad place. Mr. Johnston kindly came and visited us the other week, and one of the issues for me at the moment is to separate the policy from the bureaucratic implementation. And what I'm not clear about is some of the situations we're dealing with. Is that the policy, or is it actually the implementation? So the management might be expecting X, Y, and Z, but actually on the ground, it's interpreted differently. Anyway, independent researchers need to back up the anecdotal evidence, which is considerable.
Okay, Alex?
Just briefly, I think David is pointing out there something that is very important. We have we talk about the welfare reform process, but there is a welfare reform process going on, but there is also an issue about the way offices work, the way DWP offices work, that aren't associated with the welfare reform process. They're more associated with office practice. And I think there are two quite distinct issues there that we need to be very careful to keep a separate understanding of.
Jamie, and then Linda.
It's just I agree entirely with Mr. Simmers in terms of the requirement to try and quantify this. And I'm aware, because I'm sure we all have read the Trussell Trust's submission, where they have quantified it to a degree. So perhaps Mr. Gurr can come in and tell us that. And also, I know that Joe could maybe talk a little as well, because I was really interested to read in Community Food Murray's submission that from April 2013, when a lot of the reforms came in online, you said the impact of welfare reform was evident almost overnight. If you could maybe quantify that, that would be helpful in answering that point as well.
Yeah, Linda. I'll take the questions from the committee members, if it's okay, because you were asked for some more information by Jamie, so I'll give you an opportunity. But I'll take Linda and Kevin just to see if there's any other questions that are emerging at this time before coming to our witnesses again.
It's just this question of process and policy. Those that set the policy are responsible for the process. You know, DWP are a government agency, so it's an absolute cop-out for MD to sit there and say it's the difference between process and policy. Get it right, because there's people that are hungry. And I would suggest that the best evidence of all is the rise in the use of food banks. That's the clearest indication to me. I mean, when I was first representing East Kilbride and I knew about Loaves and Fishes, I thought about Loaves and Fishes as a group of, you know, great volunteers who went round and fed people who were hungry. My association with that was going to Renfield St Stephen's, helping homeless people in the streets for whatever reason they were there. But now, since these benefit changes,
what we're actually talking about is normal, everyday families, and it could be the families and friends of any one of us sitting around this table, people that are working and doing their best. It's completely changed, so yes, we need independent evidence, but let's not try and deny that the evidence is already there. It's absolutely there in every community in Scotland, and I would like to know from folk round the table just how that rise has manifested itself and the difference in numbers with what they're dealing with, as opposed to how it was just a couple of years ago.
Yeah, take Kevin and then I'll come back to your witnesses again.
I'm interested in what Mr. Curran said about the distances that folk are walking to access food. And I was an instant neighbour in Aberdeen a couple of weeks ago, and they ask folk where they have come from, and you know, folk had travelled 4-5 miles. No evidence of coming by car, probably couldn't afford the bus fares, which are rather expensive in Aberdeen to say the least. Now that is a huge distance for someone to walk, particularly with their bairns, to access food. Now while that may be easier, a little bit easier in urban areas, how are we tackling this in the rural areas in particular? I know that Joe will have experience, Dave will have experience of this, because sometimes walking that 4 to 5 miles maybe isn't as hard in the city of Aberdeen as it is in rural Moray, even if there is something close by. Beyond that, Convener, I think one of the reasons why we invited Dave Simmers here today is because of the experience of Aberdeen Food Bank's partnership. I think we should hear more about what that partnership is achieving, and beyond that, why it is that certain groups have chosen not to join that partnership.
Okay, that'd be an interesting point. We'll come back, as Ewan Trussell Trust was referred to by the Deputy Convener, and you did give a very helpful submission. So do you want to, sort of, having listened to some of the questions and points being made, do you want to make some observations at the moment?
Yeah, I think what Linda said was absolutely right. I think if you consider the fact that there was only 5,726 men, women and children that utilised Trussell Trust Food Bank in Scotland in 2011-2012, and then 14,318 in 2012-2013, it's terrifying that the number has now risen to over 56,000, and we're not even at the end of this financial year. We'll know what that actual number looks like by the end of this month, but that's an exponential rise in the demand for emergency food relief. And I think there's a number of things that we can take from our statistics that link that to welfare reform. I think one of the things I would like to refer to before that is the Scottish Government report that was released in December, which indicated that providers who participated in this study were in agreement that welfare reform, benefit delays, benefit sanctions and falling incomes have been the main factors driving the recent trend observed of increased demand for food aid. That for me is pretty clear. And I think in addition to that, we're not only seeing welfare reform as an issue, but also the rising cost of living. We've seen in the last 3 months a 0.7% increase in the Scottish economy. But when you look also at the fact that there's been a 4.3% rise in food costs and between 8 and 11% rise in fuel costs, it's indisputable that people are under more pressure than they ever have been. And obviously we're not seeing benefits keep pace with the rise in living costs. But for us, from our statistics, the indication is that of those 14,318 men, women and children that utilised the Scottish food bank run by the Trussell Trust last year, 15% of those, which was just over 2,000, were because of a benefit change. Now, sanctions come under benefit changes. That has since risen to 20% and jumped from third place into second place, which now accounts for 20%, which is 11,200 men, women and children, actually over 11,200. So I think that for me is a huge concern. The evidence that we're seeing every single day right across our food bank network is that welfare reforms are inextricably linked to the demand for the rising demand for emergency food relief. And in addition to that, we also indicated in our submission that 1,565 people had been referred because they were refused a short-term benefit advance. I used to be the manager of the Dundee Food Bank, managed that for 7 years. It's now been open for nine. And we saw over 1,000 referrals directly from the Scottish Welfare Fund to our Dundee Food Bank within the first 6 months of this financial year. Now, we understand that it takes time for a new system that's been devolved to the local authority to, you know, work through the teasing issues that come up. But a number of the people that we spoke to at the Dundee Food Bank indicated that they hadn't even been asked about their financial situation. They'd just been directly signposted to their local food bank. Now, that for me is a concern, because we have no intentions of becoming part of the welfare state. And there is this I think, unfortunately, that indicates a sort of underhand way of trying to weld us into the infrastructure of the welfare state. That for us is a no-no. We're not interested in going there. But I think to pick up on Kevin's point about issues of rurality, we operate in a number of extremely rural local authorities. We're currently in 26 of Scotland's 32 local authorities, one of which is the Highlands, which is bigger than the size of Wales. We currently have five projects that operate in the Highlands, and we expect that there will be another three launched in some of the more rural parts. Obviously, we rely on communities to approach us to set up food banks. But, for instance, our South Ayrshire food bank that's been open for 2 years now, it's one food bank, but it has six distribution centres right across the entire local authority in Troon, Girvan, Mabel. There's two in Ayr, and also there's one in Prestwick. So they ensure that they have a presence in each and every local community if they can, and also they have a rural delivery service that provides to the outlying areas where it's more difficult for people to get to their local job centre or to get to a food bank. So I think there's a number of ways in which we can break down those issues of rurality and remoteness, but I think it's more of an issue up here than it is south of the border.
Yeah. Certainly in the discussions I've had with you previously, that these practical problems of rurality came in when we were discussing the one in South Lanarkshire,
yeah,
where there are major centres of population but surrounded by quite disparate rural communities, and accessing food banks for those people was just practically much more difficult. So there is an appreciation that that's the case. Joe, do you wanted to...
Yeah, if it's okay, I'll just jump back to you when you were talking about the evidence that we came across about the quote where I'd mentioned almost overnight that we experienced that difference. We set up what we call an emergency food programme based on people who'd been made homeless or at risk of being made homeless or were in financial experiencing financial problems, which is obviously very different than what we are now. So, yes, we were providing emergency food aid. We saw an increase in that as a result of all the other the issues that people have mentioned, which is obviously the financial implications. Cost of living rises are not wage rises in reflection of that, but also from the point of view of people having hours cut, you know, all the implications that came along with that. So we had a slight increase, agreeably, from what we anticipated in the beginning. However, that increase had got to around 13 per month before April last year. After April last year, when I say the jump was almost overnight, we saw it within a month. And that jump of 13 per month in our records went to 59 and increased. It increased for various reasons, but the main issue that people are presenting with to the food bank is welfare and benefit problems. We're now in February, I have the figures for February, and we had 301 referrals to the food bank in February. The biggest reason is welfare. Sanctions is the biggest impact, because people who are experienced sanctions have to make the decision, as a number of people have said today, they have to make the decision of whether to heat or eat, because unfortunately they can't have help for both, so they have to make that decision. We and similar experiences are having referrals from people who can't, food is their priority, electricity, and heating is not. So we have to put out cold food boxes, and that number is increasing. On our referral forms, we actually ask for what cooking facilities people have, and the number that are now coming through, yes, they have all cooking facilities, but they can't use them because they can't afford to put the electricity in the meter. That's the implications that we're experiencing. The other thing is, obviously, on top of that, we're now experiencing, we have 30% of our referrals come from the Scottish Welfare Fund, and that is only, that's just the way that we record it. We don't know the exact figures of the benefit issues around the other referrals, but we can estimate that the majority are 90%, we're talking 90% of referrals are through benefit problems. There are other reasons, agreeably. The other issue is the rural locations. We have problems where people find it difficult. The travel issues are very difficult. If people have been sanctioned, quite often it's because they're living in an area that they can't, that travel is an issue. Not just actually the money, because public transport is very expensive, but it comes down to the very fact that, again, it comes back down to other issues where the services have been dropped, there aren't as many buses available, so people can't get in on time for their appointments, so they're then being sanctioned and having the money taken off them. And whether that's happening once with that individual or 10 times with that individual is having their basic needs taken away from them to keep warm and to eat. I mean, if we have to fulfil that need, then we will do so. So there are a number of implications for us around the rural locations. We're very lucky in the fact that we already go out to a number of rural areas, but the time and the day that we're going out to rural areas isn't necessarily when that person needs emergency food. So we're actually working under our project with the Citizens Advice Bureau. It's part of, a big part of that project is outreach, because local services, again, local services in rural areas are being taken away. If somebody has benefit problems, they have to ring a call centre that's a million miles from their issue and their problem in their community. So hopefully through the Citizens Advice project that we're in partnership with, we can help with some of those gaps.
Okay. Convener, before we move on, can I just get Jo to clarify the figures that she said? I think she said there were 13 referrals in April 2013, and now we're at 301 in February 2015. Did I pick that up right?
The 13 figure was
pre-April 2013.
Yes.
So 13 and now 301. Thank you. I think that shows the starkness of the situation.
When you said them, I thought I'd misheard, but I checked my clerks that we had the right figure. Dave, and then Caroline again.
One of the difficulties with these sessions is how you get everything you want to say in. Just a few quick points, if I may. The first, can I emphasise that one of the things about any ism is it's based on ignorance and stereotyping. And one of the challenges we've got, while we've got huge support for the public and the corporates coming in behind us on what we're doing on the food front, there's still a tremendous amount of, frankly, in my view, ignorance out there and stereotyping of the people who are using. And one of the things that's important there is the use of case studies, which a number of us have presented today, because they're very powerful in getting across to people the realities of folks' circumstance. But just to emphasise again, that those case studies do need to be backed up by independent, mere objective evidence. In terms of Aberdeen, the food bank's partnership there, I think we've got an impressive partnership with 19 organisations, including the local authority, a credit union, a housing association, and a range of churches and other voluntary organisations. And the reason we established that was a recognition in 2012 that there was an exponential growth of food banks. And please listen carefully what I'm saying just now, because I didn't want this to be misunderstood. Food banks in themselves, in our view, are not a very productive or positive activity. In themselves, they create dependency, they erode dignity, and, if you'll excuse this, they'll prop up welfare reform in isolation. They need to be linked with other support and services to people. And in the Food Bank Partnership in Aberdeen, there's a clear statement there of working in partnership with colleagues in the health service, in employability, in money advice and welfare benefits and so on, is critical. So we have a referral system going on that provides other support to people, hopefully to get them out the bit and they're dependent on the food bank. Quickly on servicing huge areas, because Grampian is big, Aberdeenshire is the second biggest authority in Scotland. FareShare UK, and Lindsay Boswell, the Chief Executive's here today to observe in the public benches. Are they called benches? Anyway, he's at the back. But FareShare UK have adopted a hub and spoke arrangement in recognition of the need to get food out to more places, basically. And in Grampian, we're going to become FareShare Grampian, where Aberdeen will be the hub and then there'll be spokes. And at the moment, we work in Aberdeenshire, and what we do there is get the food out through partner organisations. So what I'm doing just now is emphasising the importance of partnership if we're going to be effective in supporting the people. So we get the health visitors and others who are in contact with folk in need, we will send out half a dozen food parcels. They phone us when they're done and we send them out again. But it's the only way in rural areas that you're going to be effective if you've got a range of partners who are working together with you, and we want to develop the hub and spoke arrangement. One of the things Kevin asked, there's a couple of food banks haven't joined the partnership in Aberdeen. I don't think in this public forum I'm going to say much about that, other than reinforcing the message that partnership, we're stronger together. One of the issues for all the agencies we're involved with is they're under huge pressure. We're under huge pressure. And that pressure aligned with, if you've got people coming in desperate need, they're not necessarily at that first meeting responsive to other support. That comes through building a relationship with people. It's good old community work, frankly. And one of the things that I do have an issue with, and I'd like to raise today, is we take a person-centred approach. So we don't have once, twice, three times, 10 times. We're interested in the person, their individual circumstance. Where they need food, we need to get that to them, but we're also aligning that with other support and services. But we need to have, in my view, a person-centred approach that's based on that person's needs and where they're at in that time in their life.
Caroline.
Okay, just to follow on for that, I would agree that the lack of food is never a standalone problem, and it's a result of deeper issues. And that's what we need to address. We need to look at these deeper issues, whether it's the benefits, the employment, the bedroom tax, or whatever. FareShare exists to cascade that help to organisations we work with. It's not a food bank. It addresses the causes of hunger and not just the symptoms. But with that in mind, we are now providing meals for 4,500 people a day in Scotland alone. And that's a real step increase. We are redistributing in excess of £1 million of surplus food every year to around 90 projects working in Scotland. And you can see how that cascades. I feel, and this would be the opinion of the four FareShares that operate in Scotland, that we need to start to link the welfare issues with the environmental issues. And without spending ages on that, I go to an AD plant and I see in-date food going into that AD plant. And okay, we're getting energy out at the end of it, but there's people going hungry in this country. And that food could be feeding the most vulnerable members of our community. And for that, for me, that is just so wrong. And I believe that it's right that we don't think of FareShare just in context of Aberdeen and Glasgow and Dundee and Edinburgh, but that we look at, just as Joe said, that rural perspective. And we're doing a bit of a pilot where there's a wee project that's just as deserving as some of the big projects we might support in the bigger cities, down in Duns, where they're coming in once a week and picking up stuff. And the way we want to develop that is to support other people around that area and do one delivery to the one place. But I think we've got an opportunity. I think that I feel energised by... We can reduce the surplus food going to landfill. FareShare have done some research where it looks as if we're only using 1% of the food that is fit for human consumption. So there's a lot more food out there. And what we're doing, I believe, right now is that we're strengthening the voluntary sector in Scotland at a time where people are facing huge cuts in their budget. And there isn't the money there for food, and that the food is the thing that goes. And last week, Christopher Somerville, who is manager of FareShare in Edinburgh, had gone to visit a wee project that was supporting people with mental health difficulties. And he went to do what we call an advisory visit, and that's to protect the food that people like Asda and Marks and Spencers donate that's surplus, to see that it goes to the right place, so things are stored at the right temperature, we know the route where it's going to end up. And he came away and he wrote me this email that said something like, that wee project that started almost 15 years ago has developed so much, but I want to tell you why I get up in the morning. And it was a group of people who were having support because of mental health difficulties. And what they had done with that FareShare food is they had started to serve lunch. And the significant change was that people stuck around longer. But they said goodbye to each other. And they talked to each other. And that food was about building community and building care right there at the root of where things were happening. And I think that... we have an opportunity to work together with food right across, whether it's food banks or whether it's FareShare. We need to look at what resources we've got. We lack storage in a big way. We spend lots of money on storage facilities. In Edinburgh, we spend 22k a year, and that's just on storage, and we've got refrigeration. I think that we've had some joined up thinking, some funding, looking at larger storage, looking at how we work together. We have an opportunity to lead the way in this. We do need that statistics that Dave talks about. We do need the energy around the table. We do need the collaborative work. And it's the end result, as Joe says, it's about that family. And Denis says that receive that parcel. And I see it. We work with asylum seekers, refugees, who have very limited access to that sort of support. But I think it does call for us for investment in the growth, you know, to scale it up, but to be very, very aware of where the need really is and to monitor that carefully.
Thanks. Annabel, and then Denis.
Thank you, convener. And as we could anticipate from all these submissions we have received, there are many, many issues that are being brought to the table, which is very useful for the committee in its work. I wanted to raise particularly the issue of children, but before I do so, the issue of transport, as has been discussed and raised by my colleague Kevin Stewart and discussed by others, is very important. And the convener made a very good point that, you know, it's not just in rural Scotland as typically identified, it's in most of Scotland which has rurality linked to it. And when I was visiting the food bank in Dunfermline yesterday evening, you know, it was mentioned to me that, for example, somebody had walked in from Ballingarry to Dunfermline, which is some 12 miles. And it's not even just the walking in, which is quite difficult to imagine, depending on weather that we've seen, but it's also the walking back with maybe 12 kilograms of food. So I think the issue of transport is hugely important, because many of these facilities are... by definition, not going to be on the high street in terms of the space needed and so forth. And one issue we discussed last night was discussions that they're having. I'm not very sure where these discussions have got to with Fife Council, to see if, at least as far as the Trussell Trust, this was a Trussell Trust food bank, is concerned, where there's the clear red distinctive voucher, whether that voucher can be produced on a bus you know, or other form of public transport for that purpose, to get to the food bank and back. I think we have to look at very practical issues to help people in what is already a very difficult situation for them. But dealing with children, I mean, obviously we've been trying to get to the bottom of, you know, how many people are affected. We've got the figures for the Trussell Trust up to, I think, the 24th of February, as far as their involvement is concerned, of some 56,000 people. And that doesn't even take us to the end of this financial year. In 2014, we have all the other organisations, and I guess, I don't know, if you were to add up, just trying to think in terms of the information we have, we could be looking at some 90,000 to 100,000 people in Scotland. I don't think that's an unreasonable, unrealistic figure, rather, affected. But my one of my key concerns is how many children are affected within that, and do we have any idea, and perhaps that can be a point of discussion. And with respect to that, I would just mention a couple of observations. When I was at the food bank last night, the person, the volunteer I was speaking to, mentioned, as I'm sure would be the case across Scotland, the huge generosity of people across Scotland in donating. He mentioned an example of two youngsters who had given up their comic allowance to contribute to the family's donation to the food bank. And also, I met two young schoolgirls last night who were teenagers, Duke of Edinburgh Award contenders, and this was part of their volunteering. And they made the point that whilst they found it incredibly useful for them to have this experience in terms of handing over food that then, you know, that was received with such welcome by people, they also felt, importantly, as youngsters, that they were learning hugely about society, hugely, because this was making such a big impact on their lives. So just in general, I mean, this is impacting on children who are affected by the fact that their families need to go to the food banks. It's also affecting other children, and I think it's a key aspect of the debate, and I just wonder what information all of you experts have on the ground.
Okay. Denis, and then Ken.
Everything's fragmented. Really. I can only speak for East Kilbride. People go anywhere, we'll take food parcels anywhere. I've sent stuff to Oban. There's a wee haulage contractor takes it up free. But I've travelled to Peebles. I've travelled to Alexandra. And I've not always went willing. But I've always come back glad that I went. When you get there and people are breaking their heart because you brought in a bag of messages to them and maybe a couple of toys for their kids. Now, East Kilbride, we're never going to get the true figures. True figures can't come because government departments misuse the whole thing. Fact. Where you want to accept it, where you don't want to accept it, it's a fact. I get a phone call. I work with two sticks. Sometimes I don't always get out. So I get a phone call and it's always out of hours. Oh, Denis, can you help us with a bag of messages? I'm very sorry, I can't manage it now. Friday. But I could maybe manage to get something to you for 4:30. Or we stop early on a Friday. We don't work Saturday and Sunday. I'm busy Monday and Tuesday. So, what about Wednesday? What's this emergency? That family's now sitting till Wednesday waiting for something to eat. Now, the answer to that one is, oh, well, we'll just need to use our own budget. If they use their own budget properly, and when the budget runs out, we'll manage to get a true figure of the amount of people that's really struggling. I get it for other organisations. And it's the same thing, or we'll need to use our own budget. I went to the social work department, I said to her, how much food parcels do you need for Christmas? Because as you all know, this doesn't happen in a couple of days. Yeah, you give me an idea of how many. Oh, we're not using them this year. Oh, that's smashing, you don't get into hungry. No, the staff's been making a mess of the room, so we don't want to store it. East Kilbride, fact. We saw this. Well, that's the food parcel. You've not got rid of them in 2 weeks, they're getting flung out. Who are these people that doesn't want to take the responsibility of their own property? We've got Lindsay House. It's a 10-minute walk for the Civic Centre. Indiates homeless must appear in South Lanarkshire, must appear at Lindsay House. Why can't you set something up in a room in Lindsay House? Now, Lindsay House, I know they've got a room as big as that area there, lying empty. We're in a position to provide the food. It's a lot easier if somebody walked 10 minutes with two kids than it is to walk 4 miles with two kids in either end. We're more like not. There's certain people we don't want that in here. We're not allowed to store food in here. The one for Oregon, this food could be cross-contaminated or recalled. Well, if it's recalled food, it's in every television programme, every newspaper and every radio programme. And Sainsbury's would be very interested to see how you get cross-contaminated with a packet of rice and a tin of beans. So excuses. I've been doing this for 1992. This isn't new. This isn't new. This is just growing, exploding. We started off with homeless people. My wife's sitting in the back there. She's been going to meetings for 1993, and I hope this meeting sincerely brings something about. Because the only thing that changes in these meetings that we go to is the date. The last one I went to, I came home and I said, what do you think they said to me, Cathy? What do you think they were saying? And she told me word for word what we said. The only difference is we'd maybe be in the top of it by 2016. We all sit and we bandy figures about. Is people no important anymore? Is your constituents no important? Can you give us a parcel for a baby? It's going to be born on Tuesday. And the mother needs a layout. She's not entitled to be any benefits. What's the right of that child? Doesn't even matter damn what the mother's done. Surely we're social work departments and we're people in power should be looking at the benefit of that child. But that child had to get somebody to come to a food bank to see if it can get clothes. 2014. This is the real reality of this whole thing. Figures, figures, figures. What's the real figure of the people that's committed suicide through benefit cuts? Nobody able to make men's eat. People come to us and they're terrified. I don't want you know their circumstances. They've already sat in a social work department, played their heart out, then they have to walk 4 miles to me. And they feel they've got to sit down and tell me again all their problems. Well, we've got a wee sign on the door that says, no smile, no entry. And that's all they need. Come in with a wee smile on their face and they get their parcel. And I'm not there to judge them. I have a breakfast, a lunch, an evening meal and a cup of tea before I go to my bed. That's some power when I can start deciding when somebody's going to eat and if they're going to eat. And that's what we're doing here today. We're sitting here making decisions. Is somebody going to eat? Are they not going to eat? What is it we're going to do to make sure that people have no go at get? I was brought up with our parents that brought me up to believe that those that can should do for those that can't. And we think we've lost that in this society. Powers that be. It's time we woke up to reality. We don't need to have meetings to decide as the benefit cuts got a rise to do with food banks. My 7-year-old grandson's got auspices and he could tell you it is. Let's be truthful. Let's be truthful about the whole situation. The situation is people are getting penalised for being poor, for not having the ability to, not having a job, go to a food bank. How would you feel if we made a decision here today that every MP had to get their electricity and their gas cut off, their fridges and their freezers emptied, and sent to work for 4 months and get their grub off a food bank? How do you think you'd feel about that? See, that was part of the cause you had today to be an MP. You'd maybe realise what it means, what the policies really mean to people. Not financially, in there. People come to us and they're broken. Do you know what it is to storm me somebody that's breaking their heart because they can't feed their brains? That's what this is about. It's about building a society that's worthwhile. no demeaning people. Because they can't work, does they make them a lesser person? But this government's got everybody thinking that people at its own benefits is a thief, a liar, a cheat and a layabout. And that's the furthest thing for the truth. Because I live in benefits. I'm in pension support. And I'm no thief, I'm no liar, I'm certainly no layabout. Stop pigeoning people, putting them in duckets. We've got a chance to do something that's real. Real. Something positive. Don't spend it bandying figures about. Get to the heart of the matter. And the heart of the matter is people are starving. They're coming and they've not got money to feed. Can you give them something they don't need to cook? You know what? That was during the war. My wife said it the other day. You know what the difference is now? We're living a 21st century society. And we're dealing with 1930 values. Because you're needing a wee voucher to go to your food bank. That was the same as you'd be a ration book. That's what I'm going to say.
Thanks very much, Denis. Ken, you want to make a contribution?
Thanks very much. Thanks very much, Denis. It's true. I mean, I think you've captured really well there. I think the mixture of feelings that most of us have, which is a bizarre mix of shame and pride at the same time. It's really odd to be ashamed of what's happening in our society, but to be proud of the fact that compassion is driving so many people around this table and so many others and supplying food banks. Just to pick up something Ewan and Gurr and Dave Simmers said earlier, both of you pointed out that food banks by themselves, particularly this rise of food banks, I mean, there may always be a need for some kind of food aid, but emergency food banks like this can actually be unhelpful in the long term, and I think that you've both got systems in place to try and stop it becoming long term. Is there more? I think there'd be a clear message going to from all of us, or most of us, to the UK government about the welfare reform agenda itself. But is there more that we can do here in Scotland, particularly through the Scottish Parliament? I'm specifically conscious that the Scottish Welfare Fund, for example, which is there to provide crisis loans, is undersubscribed, which is, you know, doesn't quite make sense when you've got people relying, going to food banks for food when they could actually get money, which I'm sure would be far more dignified for them, make their own choices. Is there more that we can do that will actually help you get to the underlying causes, that will actually help address dependency?
Other people come back in, but Marie you wanted to make a contribution. That's Ken. We're just trying to. I'm now starting to watch the clock because I want to make sure everyone gets an opportunity to make a contribution. And I was having a chat with Marie before we started, and it'd be interesting to hear, given that Red Cross are now become part of the headlines in relation to all of this. And it'd be you can respond to anything you've heard, Marie. But if you could comment on how Red Cross have become involved and what makes that different from where you've been before?
Yeah. Well, I suppose we had no intention of particularly attracting the headline. I think the people around here are the experts around the distribution of food in the UK, though we've obviously got experience at an international and another level. I think we have become increasingly concerned about the humanitarian impact of food poverty in the UK and the increasing reliance on food banks, and actually are considering what our role and whether we should be making a strategic contribution. Internationally, we've been involved as part of the Red Cross, Red Crescent movement in looking across Europe at the response of our societies, and actually looked at 52 Red Cross and Red Crescent societies in Europe who were making responses to the economic situation in Europe. And I think there's some themes there that echo in Scotland, particularly the increasing number of new poor and the impact of food insecurity on people, which goes beyond that immediate need, meeting those immediate needs, but the actual impact of food insecurity on people's mental well-being, on their capacity to actually begin to address and to make some of those changes. I think we are, and it's helpful being here today, and we welcome the opportunity to hear what's happening, considering whether what where we could best place ourselves, I suppose, in strategically helping, and did get involved with FareShare last year in terms of mobilising our volunteers to support some of their food drives. And I think a number of people have echoed quite powerfully that humanitarian response that people in Scotland will make to people in need. But I think I would echo the concerns, I think, that Caroline and Dave talked about in terms of food banks present an immediate response. And if we don't meet people's basic needs, then we're not going to be able to help them to do other things. But the need for us to look at that resilience and actually how we offer longer term solutions at a societal level, but also an individual level. And we're very interested in developing that resilience-based approach and how we can actually help people to build on that. I think there is a concern that people have echoed around this room that we end up building food banks in as part of the welfare response rather than actually recognising them as a crisis response to a crisis that actually needs, as you said, Ken, for us to find different solutions. So I think we would see ourselves as being part of that solution. I think what the longer term response needs to be in terms of building on that resilience, I think, is something that we could develop a bit more of a response across the country to.
Linda.
Yeah, just to follow on from some of the things that have been said in the last few while, I too have a concern, as Marie has just emphasised again, that we do end up just taking food banks as the norm and it becomes part of the system. And if you'll excuse my saying it, guys, I hope that you're all campaigning to do yourselves out of jobs, you know, because that's what's really important. That has got to be the bigger picture that we hang on to. But there's always going to be people that need a hand up for whatever reasons, just like I don't believe you can ever completely eradicate homelessness. You can maybe just make it temporary, but you'll never eradicate it. You will never eradicate people who every now and then hit hard times. And that's where people like Denis and Cathy come in, who've been doing this for years, you know, for the exceptions that are now becoming the norm. But talking about the joined up stuff, yes, we should be joining up and saying that, you know, we have to help people with other things. But that shouldn't be predicated on them being hungry. That's what's the big immoral thing for me. But also, you know, what Denis said, and, you know, Denis made some claims there about lack of working together in South Lanarkshire, and I'm sure South Lanarkshire Council would have their own response to that, Denis, for, you know, for whatever reasons. But there certainly does seem to be an issue there about, to paraphrase Denis, others not quite doing their job, whether it is in fact spending their budgets or working together. And maybe it's not deliberate, maybe it's this has really hit people, this welfare reform. So it maybe is that the process, as Dave mentioned earlier, hasn't quite caught up with the policy. You know, when Ken was saying about, you know, the welfare fund, maybe more can be done under that. And there was low take up, though I understand it is getting better and the money can be carried over, and I hope that is better managed. But I think there may well, convener, be a case for following up this meeting with, you know, taking some evidence from those who are officially involved in that process, you know, to see how they make decisions, what they do. It's not just about how the people here and folk like them and all the voluntary groups relate to their local authorities and social work, DWP and others. It's about how these people relate to what's happening directly as policy that they've then got to do the process for. So I think it would be another part of this equation would be to take evidence from people like that to find out how they see the agencies around this table just now, how they work with it. And again, it's a real balance about, I don't want to see this committee in the business of saying we're going to make these awful welfare reforms work better and try and salve the consciences of some of those that are sitting in Westminster. I don't want to be doing that at all. I want a very, very strong message to go from here. But I think the understanding the bigger picture by seeing the other side of that coin is important as well.
No, I totally agree with you, Linda. I mean, we have in our work programme, you know, sort of to look at the Scottish Welfare Fund. I don't think we had specifically set up anything with the DWP, but we do that periodically, and we can, if we need to speak to the DWP again, and if we have to get the local authorities to come and speak to us about, you know, how they're working in relation to this, then that's something that we can factor in, because this is an issue that we are going to keep on top of.
Yep. Denis has just passed me a wee note. He's absolutely right. What should also be part of that is we should never forget that for the vast majority of people, all they want is to be able to work for a decent wage that takes away their absolute need to be turning up at food banks, etc. So that should also be part of that bigger picture.
Well, absolutely. I mean, that was the point that I made when Caroline mentioned initially. I mean, some of the people that she was referring to are people who are in work. So it's not just about unemployed people or people who can't access an income, it's people who are on low incomes, and we need to take all of that into consideration. Caroline, I'm coming to you anyway.
I mean, our focus at Cyrerians have certainly been on not a hand out, but a hand up, and trying to take people on that journey through the Fair Share project and other social enterprises. We're running an enterprise to employment project, which is taking people on a journey who are not even on the employability pipeline to securing a job. And for some people, that takes quite a long time. And we've got to see that job is worthwhile for them to be able to support themselves. So there's something around, I would agree totally with Mary there, in us looking at the big picture and looking at what we do in a wider context. And certainly Fair Share would be working towards us not being in existence. But when we still see all this food go to landfill, we do need to link that welfare reform with environmental, with feeding people that are going without. But I think there's also something around, we work with a food bank in North Edinburgh who actually do distribute under very stringent conditions fresh food. Fresh fruit and vegetables, as well as that pack with tins. And to me, that's about just picking up what Denis said. That's about somebody's dignity. It's about not having a constant tin of something. It's about having a bit of broccoli or some potatoes on their plate. It's about children getting fruit. We also run cooking classes, and I was brought up in a generation, and this is admitting my age, where you had cooking classes at school. It was part of your education. And people who are coming out of prison or people that have come out of care who don't know how to make a pot of soup. And it is about, for me, it's about cooking that soup. It's about the skills, the learning to do it. But it's about the building of confidence and the sharing of that meal. And for some people, Annabelle talked about children. Quite recently, last summer, through Fair Share, we had a strawberry glut. It was fabulous. You walked in at that depot, the beautiful smell of strawberries. And there was a wee lass came with her dad to pick up mum from the cooking class. She had never tasted a strawberry. She was aged 4. And the big change to that family that they evidenced in the way that we ask people to sort of chat to us to begin with about what they eat and what they buy and what they eat and what they cook and what they buy at the end of it, was that they now bought some fresh fruit. And okay, it was minimum in terms of what they could afford, but we taught them about budgeting and shopping. And that was added value. And that's where we all want there to be no food banks, there to be no Fair Share. But we have to say that there are people that are hungry, there is food going to waste. And that's where our energy needs to go, working together in partnership.
Okay. Dave, and then Jamie and Kevin, and we really are now up against the clock. So,
I think when Ken was saying about what else is there to be done, one of my bugbears for many, many years is the rhetoric of partnership needs to become the reality. That despite rampant rhetoric, so many agencies and organisations, and not speaking about the public sector only, but also the voluntary sector, sit in their own silos. And I think there's a huge job to be done to get across to us all that actually working together makes us all stronger. You've got to give there, but you also get back. And until we get that reality happening, I think we've got a problem. More importantly, people in poverty have got a problem. One of the things our working with the local authority in Aberdeen City and in Aberdeenshire actually is very good. And one of the things I would highlight there is the welfare reform grants. Partly people don't know about them. Anecdotally, we would be aware of that. But also we've got to remember a lot of folk who are possibly entitled didn't necessarily, haven't had necessarily the best relationship with the public authorities throughout their lives. And therefore there's a whole suspicion there that if they make contact, what might be the implications of that? But one of the things we've done in Aberdeen, and I don't know if it's unique, but we've now using the Accord card in Aberdeen City, we've got tills in our food bank, or two of our food banks, Instant Neighbour and ourselves. And people going in for a welfare reform grant can get loaded on nature's money to go to Asda or one of the supermarkets, but they can actually come to the food bank with that money loaded on. And they come to us and get their produce. We get the return for that grant. People go away with more than they would get from other retailers. But it's a very good win-win-win, the local authority, the beneficiary, and ourselves. So I think there's lots of room for partnership development, but there needs to be some incentivisation to do that. The final thing to mention, of course, is investment. Caroline mentioned quite, we're desperate just now for walk-in refrigeration, and I'm scrabbling around trying to find the money to get that walk-in refrigeration so we can maximise the food that's available to get out to the people. So there's money needed.
Yeah. Jamie and then Kevin, and then I'm going to finish off by coming back to you.
Thank you, Convener. And Dennis's very passionate contribution. The thing that struck me above all was the requirement for us here at Parliament to try and come up with, I think, practical solutions in that vein. I would like to echo Linda's remarks. I think we need to take a little bit more evidence to try and think about this further, and we're discussing that later, so I won't linger on that. One thing I just wanted to mention, I'm not asking necessarily for a comment on it, because I think the evidence is there in the written form. It's not something that I particularly considered in relation to this issue of food banks, but in Community Food Initiatives East, there was a reference to the Zero Waste Scotland Act and the costs on food banks for the disposal of food. That's a concern for them. And the flip side of that, in the contribution from FareShare, was the concern that food that could otherwise be utilised by food banks, and Caroline referred to this, being diverted to other usage. I think that's something we'll need to have a think about. It's not something that occurred to me as an obvious cause for concern. But one thing, and I know you're asking for this to be brief, so I'll keep it brief. Just probably only requires a yes or no answer from folk around the table. But we saw in the, I think it was Sunday Herald, or the Scotland Sunday, I can't remember which, on the weekend, some GPs saying that they are being asked to provide referrals to food banks and they're not very happy to do this. I think I saw a comment in the paper that this isn't particularly required. So just going round the table, just, you know, yes or no, is this something that your organisation requires?
No.
So it might be interesting to take further evidence where this concern has come from.
Okay, Kevin.
Thank you, Convener, and I would agree with the comments that Linda and Jamie have made about further evidence. One of the things which has concerned me about today is somebody said earlier we need to scale this up, when in reality I would like to see all of this being scaled down. But unfortunately, while we have the situation that we have with the UK government, the likelihood is that we will have to continue to scale it up. I grew up and being quite young. I suppose I would have been put in a family of working poor folk when I was pretty young. I was never hungry. I've never been hungry. I don't know how bad that actually is. And we have a situation where there is such a constant change in the benefit system at this moment in time that people kind of keep up with it. And folk are actually losing hope. And one of the things which I think we need to do is to create a system where we actually restore hope, so that folk can actually get on with their lives and live with an amount of respect. And I'd like to thank everybody around this table for their efforts, but you know, sometimes things are said and we're doing things, but not actually thinking about the practicalities. Caroline talked about cooking classes, and that's absolutely fantastic, teaching folk how to cook properly. But if the practicality is that folk can't go home and switch on their cooker because they can't afford to switch on their cooker, you know, again, we're given false hope, if you like. Convener, I think, you know, we could all go on about this today for a long while, and this session has probably been far too short. I think we need further evidence, and for the record, I would like to thank those folks around the table for the efforts that they've put in thus far.
Hey, thanks, Kevin. Ewan, I'll give the final word to you. You've listened to what's been said. Do you want to make some final comments or observations or suggestions?
Thank you very much. I just want to pick up on a few points, probably a handful of points that I just want to respond to. The first was Annabelle's comments about children. Obviously, we've given statistical evidence to indicate the amount of children that have utilised food banks since we started operating. I think the statistic we used in submission that we made was, I think, about 17,000 children of the 56,000 that had been referred to a Scottish food bank this financial year. That, for me, is a concern as a father. In addition to that, I wanted to pick up on Ken's couple of comments and questions that Ken had made. I want to actually... I think we've been unashamed to commend the Scottish Government for the work that it has done already in publishing the report in December on food aid provision in Scotland, and also the debate that Stuart McMillan recently put forward in the Scottish Parliament. So I think that for us is progress, because there's now a conversation happening, and I think if that conversation leads to creative solutions, then that's something that I would be pleased to see. I think more than anything, I think it's about educating ourselves to the extent to which this issue exists. And so I think that for me is a big issue. The one thing I would want to strongly recommend to all elected officials around the table would be that you not only go to food banks, but you engage with the people who are using the services. It's very easy to speak to me. No one cares what Ewan Gurr has to say. No one cares what John Dryley at Dunfermline Food Bank has to say. I really care about the people that are using our services. And I think if we're engaging with the people that are using our services, then that again will yield creative solutions. Also want to pick up on Linda's point. Colette Douglas-Home actually wrote an article this week in the Herald, and our opening paragraph was, "There is one man in Scotland whose ambition is to be unemployed. His name is Ewan Gurr." I would concur with your point that we do ultimately want to see a society where we are queuing up at the job centre, let's be honest. That wasn't exactly how I said it, but she made the point, and I think that's right. And I think in relation to points that have been made regarding our assimilation with the welfare state, also made my point clear a week past Sunday in the Sunday Herald, where I said we have to be absolutely aware that that if we are not careful, we could be moulded into the infrastructure of the welfare state, and that is just not our intention. For us, by working with churches and ultimately the communities, we create sustainable food banks that are not government or state reliant. It is a crucial thing to avoid ever being assimilated with the welfare state. That is not an acceptable policy shift that we want to see. And despite the fact that a number of approaches have been made from local authorities to our food banks, we have given them every indication that we would not be supportive of them entering into service level agreements or being remunerated for the amount of food that they distribute. We would prefer to be in a situation where we're resourced by the community, for the community. I think that was the main points. The other thing I think that Denis said, which I think is absolutely crucial, is we need to remember that there are people at the heart of this. Human dignity is really the key issue here. I'm speaking not as someone who provides food banks to other people. I'm speaking as someone who's used a food bank. So I know how it feels. I know the shame, embarrassment and feelings of failure that you feel when you go and utilise a food bank because you don't have enough money in your bank account to buy toilet roll. I know what it's like, you know, trying to share. The situation, really, my wife and I were in 3 years ago, was one where, you know, actually trying to procure money to run a food bank was not as easy, because it's a big issue now, and we have Support and Connect grant applications and things like that, but that didn't exist 3-4 years ago. And we were in a situation where our bank balance run very low. Fortunately, Dundee's in a very sustainable position now. But at that time, we had two big batches of funding that were due to come through, and because they hadn't come through on time, my wife and I were in a position where we had to apply for council tax benefit and housing benefit, because my income had been cut by 2/3. So I know how it feels, but I also know the love, grace and mercy and compassion that resides on the other side of the threshold of that door. I know the way that we interact with people. I know the way that we try to ensure that people are getting that support. And I think a wee bit of research that we did in our Dundee Food Bank was quite telling. Between November 2012 and March 2013, when we discovered that 2,022 men, women and children had used the food bank within that five-month period. The interesting thing was only 33 of those 2,022 men, women and children used the food bank on four or more occasions for a situation that had not been resolved in the short term. So I think that's a key thing, is that we work with people to support them towards sustainable living, and ultimately to try and address some of the issues that they may be facing. So I hope that gives quite a comprehensive overview to some of the points that were raised, and thank you for giving me the opportunity to offer some closing remarks.
No problem at all, Ewan. And thanks again to everyone for coming today, informing us, advising us, and again, you know, giving us a better understanding of just where things are at the moment, how bad things are. We have, as a committee, been going out as much as possible to try and get as clear a picture as we can. We've visited local authorities, we've visited food banks, we've been to the DWP centres, we've been to ATOS centres, we've done as much information gathering as we can, and it just keeps adding and adding. I mean, we've heard some horrendous individual circumstances from people who've informed us. We've heard collective information, which again has been alarming and concerning. You know, things that stick with me, hearing one local authority tell me that they know of groups of people who are, you know, waiting at the back of supermarkets for food to be thrown out so they can go into the bin and try and find food. We've heard of the stories of people walking miles. We've heard the stories of mothers and fathers going without food in order to keep their children fed. And as Denis kept reminding us, this is 2014 and we should not be hearing those stories, but we are. So we'll continue to listen to people like yourself, Denis. We will collect the information as best we can. We'll get it from wherever we can, and we'll try and inform government as best we can as to how we take these issues forward. And because the question kept coming up, we have local authority officials coming in front of us on the 18th of March to discuss the Scottish Welfare Fund. So we'll obviously be taking forward some of the issues that have been raised here today with them directly. As I said, if needs be, we'll get the DWP back in again. We'll speak to whoever we need to speak to. That's what we've been trying to do, and that was the reason for this discussion this morning. So again, thank you to all of our witnesses for the contributions that we made. I certainly feel better informed. I don't feel better about having had to hear what I had to hear, but that's the situation that we're in at the moment, and we will do what we can as a committee to try and make sure that what you brought to us this morning is addressed. But thanks very much again to you all. And I'll suspend the meeting for a few minutes to allow us to change over to our witnesses. Up the meeting again. We're still on our agenda item two. It's the second panel that we have in front of us, and it's we're again looking at the food banks and whether there are possible links to the UK government's welfare reforms. And our second panel is in front of us, and I'd like to welcome Dr. Filip Sosenko, who's a research associate, and Dr. Nicola Livingstone, who's a teaching fellow and research associate at Heriot-Watt University. Do you want to make a short introductory comment, tell us a bit about your work, and then we'll open it up to questions and further discussion, if that's okay?
Certainly. Thank you very much for inviting us along today and giving us the opportunity to report to you on what our key findings were from our Scottish Government commissioned report, the Overview of Food Aid in Scotland. Really, it was interesting to be here for the roundtable discussion, because a lot of what has been expressed there has really been complementary and reinforcing to what we have found and what our research brought out in terms of food aid provision in Scotland. So we conducted our research in September of last year, and we were commissioned to do an overview, so a scoping study really, of food provision across Scotland. In that respect, we had three objectives to consider. So identifying the sort of providers that exist across certain areas in Scotland, what's the scale of provision, how do these providers monitor, if anything, do they monitor at all, those people who are using their services. Where does the Trussell Trust fit within this provision across Scotland, and how does their data reflect general trends that other food aid providers have experienced? And the third thing that we were requested to investigate was to make recommendations as to whether they can effectively monitor supply and demand of food aid, and going into the future, is it possible to make links between welfare reform and food aid provision, or the increases in food aid that we've seen over the last couple of years? So in that respect, we identified eight areas for investigation. So we concentrated on everything across the spectrum from urban to rural. So we had eight case study locations: Glasgow City, Dundee, Inverness, Fort William, Stirling, Falkirk, and then Angus, which included Curramuir and Forfar. So everything from the very rural to the very urban. What we did whenever we identified our food aid providers was to contact them initially by email, make initial contact, and then we conducted semi-structured telephone interviews at a pre-arranged time. So really, we've spoken to people who have been involved in the management and the provision of food rather than the service users themselves. So I'm going to reflect on some of the key findings. I'm going to then pass you over to Filip, who's going to discuss a little bit more about the welfare reform and the Scottish Welfare Fund. But generally, across the board, there was a notable trend in terms of what we were getting from our food aid providers. So a general, consistent and exponential increase over the last couple of years. As Ewan Gurr mentioned earlier, the key things that were influencing those that were using and accessing the food banks was benefit sanctions, benefit delays, welfare reform, especially including the benefit or the bedroom tax, and also this sort of disconnect between the living wage and the changes in real incomes, or the lack of changes in real incomes, but the increase in cost in everything else, including food. So these were our key findings. Glasgow, in terms of the Trussell Trust's representation, they were seen to represent about 20% of the food aid provision in Glasgow City. So there's about 35 providers in Glasgow. There's some overlap between those that provide food and those that provide food parcels. Some providers do a variety of both, like the Salvation Army, for instance. And then, generally speaking, in all the other locations, Trussell Trust, as a food bank provider, were the dominant source of food banks and food aid across Scotland in our chosen locations. So obviously we've looked at eight particular regions, but it is very difficult to make a sort of Scottish-wide comment. But the general trend is that the numbers of people needing access to food is consistently increasing. So all providers have experienced increase in demand. Generally speaking, though, supply does not seem to be an issue. There were some links made to this sort of element of corporate social responsibility, a lot of supermarkets getting involved, and surplus food redistribution, which was seen as a very positive thing by those people who were providing the food aid and the parcels. I suppose there is a question of balance between whether or not the growth in food banks is encouraging more people to use the food banks and getting the supermarkets involved in providing the food. And does that actively encourage people to use the food banks? I think that the food banks are addressing a need rather than creating a need, and that they are a symptom of a wider cause. And that if there was no need for them, then we wouldn't have them at all, really. Generally speaking, logistical issues, I know that they were brought up in the earlier session, not just in rural areas, but also issues regarding distribution within cities too. We had anecdotal evidence of people who were walking 9 miles in order to get to a food bank to collect food parcel where there was no food left and having to walk 9 miles back. There, in Dundee, they've opened additional distribution services. So they've now got their main central food bank in Dundee and three additional distribution points. So it is about trying to make the food banks more accessible to the people who need the food. In rural areas, some of the food bank managers that we spoke to commented on certain charities or local businesses giving them access to vans so that that can help their distribution. So especially in Angus, so Currymuir Food Bank and Forfar, they cover an area of, I think, 850 square miles. There was some commentary that a lot of the people in the more rural areas don't have the awareness or the knowledge of how to access food from a food bank, or that food banks are there to support them. One interviewee particularly mentioned that elderly people are very hidden in their area because they're not aware that they have access to food from food banks when they need it. They are a symptom of a wider cause, as I said, and there is a stigma associated to food banks. There are different clientele coming to use food banks than there are to use the more informal soup kitchen types. Across the board, the people that are coming to access food from food banks and get food parcels for their short-term three-day period typically are housed and do have access to facilities that will enable them to cook the food that they get. The soup kitchens typically have got a slightly different sort of clientele, so other vulnerable people in society who are maybe experiencing different types of crisis, such as homelessness. In some of the more rural areas, however, it was noted that there was a crossover and an overlap between the people who were accessing both the more informal services for hot food meals and the like, such as soup kitchens, and people accessing the food banks as well. Let's see. I think that I will hand over to Filip at this point.
Thank you very much. I just wanted to make 3 points linked to the roundtable discussion. Last autumn, I interviewed a policy manager from the one of the largest food sector support organizations in Scotland, and she said that food banks are now part of the infrastructure for dealing with crisis. and I think this captures the situation very well. However, I wanted to point out that we shouldn't forget that, as people mentioned before, many Scots do not have access to food banks because they live too far away from them. But also, if they happen to live in the area which is served by a Trussell Trust food bank, they can only receive emergency crisis help, which takes them effectively for 9 days, which is 3 food parcels. And this is not criticism of Trussell Trust. This is a factual statement. You've got 3. You can get 3 food parcels. Each parcel lasts you for 3 days. Now, my point is that there are high numbers of people who have to go without means of support for longer periods, for longer than 9 days. And I just wanted to quote some statistics. In 8 months to June 2013. There were 48,000 JSA claimants in Scotland sanctioned for 4 weeks, and there were further 5,300 JSA claimants sanctioned for 3 months. Now, if you are sanctioned for 3 months and you can get food, emergency food for 9 days, how are you going to survive the remaining time? So I think, and as I said, this is not my criticism of Trussell Trust. There is a reason why they do things this way. But what I wanted to say is, you know, there's a high number of people out there who can only use food parcels for a short period of time. And also in relation to that, sanctioned JSA claimants are not eligible for crisis grants from the Scottish Welfare Fund. They cannot apply for a crisis grant. And I've had a conversation about this with colleagues from the welfare division of the Scottish Government, and they said that there are legal limitations as to what how they set eligibility for a crisis grant, because they legally they are not meant to subvert what the DWP is doing. And if they if crisis grants if people who have been sanctioned were eligible for crisis grants, that would undermine what the the policy of the DWP. So I'm not a constitutional lawyer. I don't know the ins and outs of it, but there is a legal issue here with broadening the eligibility for crisis grants to include sanctioned people. So that's the first point that I wanted to make. The second point, I wanted to engage with what Lord Freud said in July last year about the link between rising demand for food parcels and the welfare reform. He said, that was July last year, the provision of food bank support has grown from provision to 70,000 individuals 2 years ago to 347,000. All that predates the reforms. Now, I would say that there is a welfare reform was not the main or an obvious factor fueling demand for food aid prior to April 2013. However, there is enough evidence to say that from April 2013, it's become a major factor fueling demand for food aid. However, Lord Freud's statement, I believe, is factually incorrect. The changes to the benefits to the welfare system started before April 2013. Yes, the majority or the harshest changes happened in April last year, but prior to that, what happened was that JSA sanctions got tougher in October 2012. That's 5 months before before April 2013, and also the absolute number of JSA sanctions was rising a lot already from about 2009. In October 2008, there were 3,250 JSA sanctions in Scotland. In October 2010, 2 years later, there were 8,500. That's a jump from, in absolute numbers, from 3,250 people sanctioned to 8,500 people sanctioned. And I believe that that's what fueled the rise of the increase in demand for food aid in Scotland. The figures for October 2012 were 6,240, so a slight drop, but still, you know, it's twice as many as JSA claimants sanctioned as in 2007-08. So that's one thing, is that there were already more people, JSA claimants sanctioned in Scotland in 2010-11-12, but also and sanctions got tougher in October 2012, which predates April 2013. But also in 2011, the coalition government introduced new local housing allowance caps and changed the way local housing allowance is calculated, and that's for private sector tenants who rely on local housing allowance. That's diminished their budgets. So that's, again, that predates April 2011. Also, in April 2012, changes were made to the eligibility for working tax credits. So couples with children since April 2012 have to work at least 24 hours a week to be eligible for working tax credits, whereas prior to that it was 16 hours per week. So there is a cohort of families in Scotland whose budgets budgets deteriorated before April 2013. So I'm saying all that because, you know, Lord Freud said all that predates the reforms, and that's to me, that's factually not correct. It's just that the harshest changes to the benefit system, to the welfare system, happened in April 2013, and so I would say prior to April 2013, the main reasons for rising demand for food aid was poor administration of the benefit system, so benefit delays that predates the welfare reform. And also rising food and energy prices that squeezed families, households already, you know, in 2009, 2010, 2011. However, it is clear to me that after April 2013, the welfare reform is one of the key factors fueling the rise in demand for food aid, and particularly the bedroom tax. The benefit uprating, the fact that benefits were uprated by 1% rather than by with the inflation, the reassessments of people on DLA, the benefit cap and south of the border, localization of council tax benefit as well. And I think the strongest evidence for there being this link is that the demand for food aid grew at a faster rate after April 2013 than before April 2013, and that's what Trussell Trust figures show, that when the reform hit in April 2013, from that point the demand for food aid has grown faster than before. So that's the second point I wanted to make, and the last point is regarding further evidence. A few people around the table called for collecting more evidence or going beyond anecdotal evidence about the impact of welfare reform on the demand for food aid. Well, as a social researcher, I would say that the evidence collected, data collected by the Trussell Trust regarding, you know, referrals, why people get referred, this data is both robust and reliable. It's not anecdotal at all. Obviously, other food banks were talking about their, you know, what their clients tell them, and that's, yes, maybe that's not systematic and it's closer to anecdotal, but statistics collected by the Trussell Trust is robust and reliable. And I don't see a reason why it shouldn't be relied on. And to be honest, I don't think there is much need for further evidence. I think this statistics can be relied on in the future. It's a huge data set. It's not thin, and it's systematically collected data in a consistent manner. I don't have issues with the quality of it as a social researcher. Also, in our study, we found that it would be difficult to collect any additional evidence on the link between the welfare reform and the growing demand for food aid, mainly because food parcel providers and soup kitchens do not want to overburden themselves with collecting information, case records. And basically, they would only collect information that is relevant to their operations, and this kind of data would not be relevant to their operations. So there would need to be some strong incentive. They would need to be strongly incentivized to carry out additional data collection. And yeah, there are several issues with that. Thank you.
That's really helpful. Thanks very much for.
I just wanted to round off with a final thought, but also just building on what Filip said about additional providers like the soup kitchens and the drop-in centres and the like. One of the issues for them was in collecting data, they felt that it would overstep boundaries with their clientele, that the people who were coming to access the food aid from them would actually potentially become deterred by not coming, by having to give this information, and it may actually dissuade them from continuing to use the services. There's also a difference between the users of food aid, such as soup kitchens and other food banks that are not Trussell Trust affiliated. They were seen as being more informal and unconditional in terms of how they give and distribute food aid, whereas obviously the Trussell Trust has got conditions attached to it and you can only get 3 food parcels within a 6-month period. But there are food aid providers out there who do provide food on a regular, sometimes weekly basis to the same clients over and over again. Something else, just a very brief final point that is sort of reflective of the additional research that Filip and I have carried out since we've done this report. And it's reflective of the situation in the US and Canada. And I'm not sure if any of you are aware of how they use food banks in these countries. And really, they emerged in sort of the late 70s, early 80s, and they have become an extension of the welfare state. They are a social safety net. They've become normalised, and they are embedded in society. They're entrenched. And at the minute, it's quite interesting to note that there are volunteers in Canada at the minute through this organisation called the Freedom 90 Charter, and they've been working with food banks and volunteering for food banks for 20-odd years, and they are now working to make food banks obsolete because they feel that the government is now too reliant on them and are basically using them as an extension of the welfare state. So they're using them as a way in which they're not having to fulfil their obligations to people in society. So there's an academic, I just want to finish off with this quote, there's an academic called Riches, I'm not quite sure, and he was reflecting on the Canadian situation in 2002.
and he suggests that food banks enable governments to look the other way and neglect food poverty, nutritional health and well-being. In countries where they're at their very infant stage, the question of whether to support their development should be a matter of urgent public debate. And I think that that's pretty much where we're at today. So just wanted to leave you with that final thought.
Yeah, thank you very much. And that's the document itself is very informative, but your contribution this morning has certainly clarified a few issues. For me, you know, just whether there is a link between the statistics we heard at our round table this morning and the welfare reform changes, why we needed scientific evidence of that is I'm not questioning you at all, but it's almost to me as there's no questioning, you know, whether bears do certain things in their natural habitat. There seems to be a general concern, though, about, you know, as you said, this Canadian study, and again the concerns were expressed this morning about food banks and the food provision becoming part of the system. My concern in relation to this relates to the Scottish Welfare Fund, because we've had evidence from government officials, we've had anecdotal evidence again presented this morning, that as part of that process that officials at the Scottish Welfare Fund are referring people to food banks. Now, is that a concern for you in respect of what the experience in Canada was, or is this just having to accept the reality that, you know, the welfare changes have created this huge problem and therefore there is a need to refer people because that's the only way that they can be helped?
Probably a mixture of both, especially when you consider the other informal providers who do provide food on an unconditional basis. Do you have any thoughts on that?
Well, it just happens that I'm currently I've been leading on the evaluation of the Scottish Welfare Fund. We are nearing the end of the fieldwork. We've interviewed probably 70 applicants to the Welfare Fund, Scottish Welfare Fund, by now. And what I can say is that referring to food banks is fine and is useful to applicants as long as it doesn't replace the grant. And there's only anecdotal evidence out there, like from Ewan mentioned Dundee City Council. There's anecdotal evidence that on some occasions Scottish Welfare Fund officers, rather than giving a crisis grant, they would refer the applicant to the food bank for 3 days worth of food, but I have no you know, grounded evidence for that. But what I'm saying is that it's particularly all right to give a grant and refer to the food bank as an additional source of support.
Yeah, because again, the information we have, if you look at the data so far, and the Scottish Government have just produced a bit more in terms of that, there are more people trying to access the Scottish Welfare Fund, there are more people being supported by the Scottish Welfare Fund, but the actual financial awards given to individuals, the average has gone down. So it looks as though there's a combination of things happening, that people are being supported by the Scottish Welfare Fund, but not always in terms of finances, but that's something that you're comfortable with.
The study that I haven't got access to the latest statistics on the amounts, average amounts given in crisis grants, it's definitely in most cases it's not big money at all. It's short term emergency crisis help. People, applicants, often find themselves in need to apply for another one, and they can only apply for three crisis grants within a rolling 12-month period. There is this question of what you do when you've exhausted your three crisis grants. And you're still in need you know, and if it happens that you've exhausted your food bank vouchers as well. Yeah,
it's a major concern. You can see where the problem's escalating. I'll go to Jamie, to follow by Linda.
Thank you, Convener. I have to say, Dr. Loves and Dr. Sosenko have answered a lot of the questions. They're comprehensive opening remarks, which I thank them for, but there are a few things there. And Dr. Loves, you made the clear point that food banks are addressing a need. They're meeting a demand. They're not driving the demand. And I wonder what you think then, because I've seen the copy of the letter that the UK government sent to Glasgow City Council. I've also seen it referred to in the press recently. UK government ministers suggesting that one of the things that's caused this growth in demand for food banks and growth in the number of food banks is that supermarkets are somehow being more efficient in dealing with food waste. I mean, to be frank, I find this laughable. I don't know what you... Well, I'd find it laughable if it wasn't so sad, but I don't know what you think of this suggestion. Is there any evidence that this is the case?
In terms of them driving the food banks and the growth of food banks, no. I think that they're supportive from the evidence that we have. They can seem to be supportive of food redistribution and surplus food redistribution, which can't be a bad thing, really. Has got to be taken as some element of positive aspect of having food banks, because people are getting access to food. There are food banks out there in the more rural areas who, even though they are Trussell Trust food banks and typically take only non-perishable foods, some supermarkets will give them perishable foods as well. So they get fresh fruit and vegetables, which they then redistribute in addition to the food that they would typically give out in a food parcel as well. So I think that really the recipients are the people who are benefiting from this redistribution. And it's not just the supermarkets. I mean, a lot of the people that we spoke to commented on the vast amount of support from the local communities as well. And a lot of people feel that it is very empowering to the people in the local communities who are driving the food banks through churches and also through active volunteering as well. So it is coming from the wider community too. The supermarkets are really only an element in terms of their provision in donating food and giving food to food banks. Some don't give food directly. Tesco's, for example, have an arrangement with the Trussell Trust, and they have the Trussell Trust food banks have got two national collections per year, and they also have smaller local collections which happen, I think, around four times per year as well. So they go to supermarkets, set up outside, they give people a shopping list of goods that they would find useful. People can choose whether or not they want to contribute to the food banks, so they're doing these massive food collection drives for the non-perishable foods. Then Tesco's will tot up how much they have collected in terms of the overall food value, and then they give 30% of that value to the food bank, so the food bank can then buy additional food as it needs it. So it's not just redistribution of surplus food, it's also giving the food banks access to additional food when necessary.
So when Dr. Sosenko said earlier that Lord Freud is incorrect to say that welfare reform is not a driver in the increase in demand for food banks, anyone that's also saying that supermarkets being efficient in dealing with food waste is also wrong?
Yeah, I would say that in our study we found that food banks that took part in our research do not tend to run out of supply. So if supermarkets are even keener to donate and do it more efficiently, yeah, it can't increase the the demand, because it's the supply side. So so all that it would do is it would make food banks more comfortable about their supply
and ensuring they have consistent supply.
Putting it in a different way, supermarkets would only fuel demand for food aid if food banks sporadically run out of supply, because then there would be more supply, more consistent supply, and more people using food banks. But that's not what we found in our study. The supply is always of concern for food bank managers, but they don't tend to run out of food.
So at best, Lord Freud and these other UK government ministers are misinformed, to say the least.
I would say that, yeah.
At best. Mm-hmm.
Well, I think that's where everything has been pointed to this morning.
Linda.
Yeah, thanks. I was interested, I think both of you referred to it, you know, the formality of the Trussell Trust, both in collecting data, which is good, but also that you can only go three times in the six-month period. I'm also aware, as Denis Curran said earlier, and you've confirmed that the smaller food banks, for various reasons, don't keep such data and are less judgmental. But I wondered if you were able to find any link between those who perhaps had been to the Trussell Trust the three times, whether the same people were perhaps presenting at the more informal centres, or was that not something you were able to pick out?
Well, we put in probably 30 or 40, but still, like, that uh-huh. was it wasn't yeah. Big enough to probe in detail. Yeah.
I was just interested, like in my own area, which is why I was so keen that Denis Curran from Loaves and Fishes was here. We don't have the Trussell Trust. We don't have any of the bigger, more organised food banks. It's entirely run by volunteers through Loaves and Fishes and through the churches. And I'm just wondering whether the client profile is any different in some of these areas. That's something we can probe. But I was also interested, convener, in Dr. Sosenko, you're saying that you didn't feel more research was necessary on this particular question.
Statistical evidence on why people get referred to food banks.
And I think has been shown, yeah, as far as you're concerned. Yeah, I would hate to compromise you in any way by my words here.
I think it comes down to the issue of robustness and how yes. there's this sort of approach from the UK government that there is no robust evidence. But generally what we find from our snapshot across Scotland was that the Trussell Trust data was generally indicative of the full situation across Scotland in terms of the growth of food aid. And that the data is... really?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I just wondered if your research had shown up in your own view, what further research may be useful if that's something you reached a view on.
Can I just comment on what you were saying about the informal food providers? We came across one food bank in Dundee that was run by a church. It's been run by the same lady for about 25 years. Mm-hmm. And even though they've seen a massive increase in users, they do not want to become affiliated with the Trussell Trust as a food bank because they do not want to have to conform to the referral system. And I'm sure that there are a multitude of other food banks that are independent and that are out there and feel similar about the way that it's conditionalised.
Mm-hmm. Well, regarding any further research, I'll be really interested in find out what journeys people make from the point when they become food insecure to when they knock on the food bank's door. Because from other studies, we know that people, going to a food bank tends to be the last resort. But what exactly people do, what strategies they employ, that would be very interesting to find out.
So we've looked at it from the perspective of the providers, so getting a user perspective would be really helpful.
I mean, I can bring a few voices from the evaluation of the Scottish Welfare Fund, because I've interviewed a few people who've used up their food bank vouchers, you know, and they had no income, and things obviously using family and friends, support from family and friends is the main source of support that people try to use before going living off benefits that the partner has, which, you know, if it's a couple with a child and the mother has, with a young child, the mother has her benefits, but the whole household live off her benefits. That's not a comfortable situation. I've been told by one of the applicants for the Scottish Work for Crisis grant that she shoplifted from a garage. You know, so this happens.
I think for me, one of the interesting things that could be expanded in terms of the people that use food banks is looking at the wider perspective in terms of how the economic situation is at the minute. We know the UK government are happy at the moment because unemployment has been pushed down to 7%, apparently. Maybe this just reflects a wider shift in how people are adopting different working patterns and how maybe you're only working 18 hours a week or 20 hours a week and you're working on minimum wage. Is that having a knock-on effect on people's need to use food banks because this minimum wage or this living wage is actually insufficient to support people?
Yeah, that's quite amazing. By the contributor Dennis. This morning, there are people in low income. You don't necessarily have to be unemployed or totally devoid of income, but there are people in low incomes who are having to access food banks.
Yeah. Something on this point, because somebody's mentioned budgeting skills, and I very much support it when third sector organisations teach people who want to be taught budgeting skills how to do it. But you can be the champion of the world in budgeting skills, but to be on such low income that you just can't make it till the end of the month. So it's not just about budgeting skills.
Annabelle?
Just a couple of quick points. On the issue of the Trussell Trust and the conditionality, I know that you state this quite fairly in your report at paragraph 412 and page 11, whilst the general rule is 3 times 3, the individual food bank manager has some discretion, taking into account a whole series of issues, I guess, in terms of crisis versus long-term sustainability versus other issues. So there is a discretion there on the part of the local food bank manager, and I don't know to what extent, if at all, the Trussell Trust keep separate statistics about the use of that discretion. It might be interesting to find out. But I mean, it's fair that it's the general approach is as you have described. Looking, and many of the points that I wanted to explore have been dealt with. Looking at the point you raised at the end about the additional research you'd carried out into the USA and Canada, I just wonder also, and taking up the comments made from the representative of the Red Cross this morning, to what extent has there been any examination of what's happening in other European countries? And in that regard, I do recall that there was an EU fund recently in the news that would have supported activity in this area, but the UK government, for some reason, did not seek to apply for any funding under that budget stream. I don't know if that's formed any part of any additional research you've yet carried out.
No. The report that was published last week that was released by the UK government that DEFRA had put forward, they reflect on food banks and food aid provision in Germany. And in addition to the US and Canada as well. So that's really the only other country that I'm aware of in terms of offering a slightly different, more European perspective in food aid provision. But,
yeah. Kevin and then Ken.
Thank you, Convener, and I'd like to thank Dr. Sosenko and Dr. Livingstone for the evidence that they've given today. Most of the points that I was going to ask have actually been covered by others, but I'd like to go back to what Dr. Livingstone termed as our final point, our final thought, and she was talking about health and nutrition because of the use of food banks. And I wonder if there has been any studies either here or elsewhere about the impact of the over-reliance on what is mainly processed food in a lot of cases.
Journal papers and articles and publications that reflect on how the food that is typically redistributed from the food banks in the US and Canada does not meet nutritional standards. I'm not sure about the UK at all, but certainly from a historical perspective, what they have looked at, it's insufficient in terms of nutrition.
Convener, we obviously have a growing obesity problem here, and one of our colleagues, Denis Robertson, last week held a conference in eating disordered awareness here. I wonder if there has been any studies from the use of food banks showing that there's more prevalence to be obese or there is more prevalence to have an eating disorder.
Not that I'm aware of. And I do think it would be very hard to
qualify. Well, there is. It's probably from the US. Yeah. They are, you know, the food banks have been part of the scene there for ages, and there's lots of research on food banks.
But I do think there is certainly potential to look at the nutritional value within the UK of the food that is redistributed through food banks.
I mean, I think that that's extremely useful. As I said earlier, I kind of imagine actually going hungry, but I think that could lead you to doing things that you wouldn't normally do as a person because you're forced to do it. And I hope actually this doesn't go on for as long as that we actually have the ability to do some of that research, and that we can deal with this problem quite quickly and see the gradual demise of food banks. But, you know, I think this is maybe storing up something which is going to cost society here and people here a hell of a lot in the future.
Thanks, Gavin. And Ken.
Thank you. Two questions. The first, just picking up from a comment that Linda Fabiani made slightly earlier about whether you're able to make any distinction between the people using food banks. From reading your report, I thought that there were broad distinctions, that there's a difference between those using inner-city soup kitchens and those using Trussell Trust food banks.
Generally, the clientele appears to be slightly different. As I mentioned earlier, those people who are accessing Trussell Trust food banks typically are housed and are on lower incomes or experiencing crisis potentially for the first time, whereas those that are using more informal food banks or soup kitchens in the inner cities typically tend to be regular clientele who have got an alternative type of crisis, so potentially homelessness, drug addiction, alcoholism.
Complex needs
in general. Yeah. So people who would actually, in some respects, the Trussell Trust would actually, because of their system of referrals, they would evade these people, because a lot of these people wouldn't have the capacity to go to get referred and then get to a food bank and even use the food that the food bank would give them.
And the second question is really coming on to perhaps what I thought was a very significant remark, which is your last remark, Dr. Livingstone, about the fact that we need to act as a matter of urgency before these food banks and this way of life becomes entrenched. If we really want to help people. A lot of the people giving evidence this morning place great stock on trying to not just give out food aid, but try to help people help themselves. Cyrenians were talking about through cooking skills and building capacity and so on, confidence. A number of contributors talked about it. Has there been any work at all done, any research done, that shows the success or otherwise of such approaches? In other words, what can we do, particularly through the Scottish Parliament in particular, what can we do to tackle reliance on food banks? How do we, is it by making crisis loans more available, by giving people money so they make their own choices, or is it through capacity building or help out? What might work?
I think a good example of a very sort of cohesive community group that we came across was Dundee. So they have got a community partnership that's run by Faith in the Community, I think, by a gentleman called Gordon Sharp, who's been involved in the community in Dundee for many years. And they have got a community partnership which meets regularly and takes sort of the opinions and the experiences of people who are providing food aid for a variety of different people across the community. So everything from the drop-in centres to the Trussell Trust Food Bank to the likes of the Salvation Army, who are providing and addressing a slightly different need as well. And they do suggest that it is about community action, it is about supporting people in the long term, that the food aid provision is temporary and short term, and that it's about how you build on what happens next after that. So that certainly is an opportunity that could be capitalised on in terms of helping people, as Filip was mentioning and as was mentioned this morning, with budgeting, with cooking, with being able to successfully grow out of reliance or dependence on food aid provision.
To me, such actions are obviously would be useful, but the main thing is repairing the safety net. Mm-hmm. It's been torn apart, and unless it's repaired, it's not going to change. People will be coming to food banks. But there is obviously an issue of, you know, the Westminster government and the Scottish government powers as regarding welfare.
Indication of questions for anyone. So again, thank you very much for providing the initial research, but informing us again in a bit more depth to the work and to answering our questions. And it may be, I think we have you back in front of us at some point in the future, Dr. Sosenko. So
in 2 months' time.
Yeah. So we'll continue to monitor the research that you're providing, which has been very helpful to us. And thanks again for that. Thank you. Okay, I'll suspend the meeting for a couple of minutes until the witnesses have had a chance to leave. Our fact-finding visit to DeafBlind Scotland as part of our USA work, looking at the impact of welfare reform on individuals. I think, Jamie, you're going to lead off on that.
Thank you. First of all, can I place on record my thanks to DeafBlind Scotland for hosting myself, Ken, and Rebecca, who came along to support Ken and myself at our visit. I'm not going to read over the whole report that's in front of us, because obviously people have that, but I think the main thing that I certainly took from the visit, and it's not dissimilar to the experience of other groups of people, I think, with a particular condition, that they're dealing with a system that doesn't particularly meet their distinct needs. But I think it was particularly acute for deaf-blind people, and perhaps reflects a wider issue of society not recognising the factors affecting deaf-blind people. It was pretty clear that from the individuals who spoke to us that it's a condition that isn't always visible to people. Sometimes neither element of their condition, the fact that they have hearing loss or sight loss, is particularly apparent to people that are dealing with them, and almost invariably one or other isn't apparent when the other one is. So that's an issue perhaps for wider society, but I think it's particularly relevant for these individuals trying to interact with the welfare system. One of the things that we were told about was the lack of necessary specific support. We were told by one person who's deafblind that there are only 4 social workers dealing with the deaf, with deaf people in Glasgow. That's not even specifically deaf-blind people, that's deaf people. One service user was telling us that they'd been put with the older people's social work team, even though she herself was only 45, and this lack of expertise can sometimes cause difficulties for them accessing the welfare system. There's also an issue in terms of the lack of support, financial assistance to complete application forms for Social Security. We had one individual who is entitled to 8 hours of guide communicator support. Each individual who's there relies heavily on their guide communicator, and he was having to essentially use a huge swathe of that time, virtually all of it, just to complete these forms, and it left him with no time to go out and do the other necessary things. Had to go see the GP, get out and about, so that was an issue. There's also a concern about lack of information available on what PIP and other benefits mean to those currently receiving DLA, certainly in a format that they can access. There was a call from DeafBlind Scotland for people who are registered blind and deaf to automatically receive benefits and not be subject to assessment. I think, crucially, not be subject to reassessment. That was a call. So my suggestion, Convener, would be that we take this on board as the part of the work that we are doing, and I think perhaps we want to communicate our findings to, certainly I think we need to communicate them to the DWP, because that's very relevant for us as a committee. And also there were other issues that were touched on that perhaps we should maybe make, I don't know, the Health and Sport Committee aware of, because maybe they're wider issues and not necessarily for this committee.
Is there anything you want to add?
Thanks very much, Convener. And yes, just to support what Jamie said, it was a very helpful meeting. We met, there were three officers from DeafBlind Scotland. There was Gina O'Malley, who we all know is the main point of contact with us, Ruth Dorman, who's their chief executive, and Stephen Joyce, who all spoke for the organisation. And then we had three members of three people who use DeafBlind Scotland who spoke to us as witnesses, as it were. Christine Fry, Frankie Thompson and Maria Crawford. And what was striking from a welfare reform point of view was that the messages were very similar to those we've heard from other witnesses, the difficulties they're experiencing with welfare reform. But from a deaf-blind point of view, I think there was two points in particular that struck me. One is that deaf-blind people may or may not have support or care and support needs, but before they have care and support needs, they have communication needs. And the difficulty is that it is there. If you're deaf, your communication needs are met in many circumstances automatically, and then you're assessed for your care. If you're deaf and blind, your care, your communication needs are assessed as part of your care. It comes out of your care budget. Now, this is, you know, whatever care needs you have, you cannot even begin to access anything. You can't go out of the house, you can't go to the shops, you can't fill in a form to be reassessed for your work capability assessment or anything else to do with the welfare agenda without using your guide communicator, the point that Jim was making earlier. And there's actually a bizarre difference between deaf people and deaf-blind people, with deaf people automatically getting support and deaf-blind not coming out of their care. And it's quite upsetting to those in the deaf-blind community, some of them who had been deaf before and had gone blind. And the second point was, which Jamie touched on there, is that deaf-blind people are not going to get better. And it's yet another of those many examples at the heart of the welfare reform agenda where we are reassessing people who clearly are not going to improve. We're treating them as if they're going to improve when they cannot improve. And that is not just a source of frustration, and it's not just illogical, it's very upsetting for the deafblind. And the two words that were repeated over and over again at this meeting were that they were stressed and anxious about it, and they felt bullied. And it came across, and as I say, it's a very familiar story for other experiences of welfare reform agenda, but with this sort of added complication on top. And I would agree with Jamie that actually this issue about why deaf-blind people have to have their communication needs met out of their care budget as opposed to out of a communication budget might need to be looked at separately, maybe explored with the Scottish Government. Because, for example, if you go to Glasgow City Council, the people assessing and helping you may not have any knowledge or any experience of deafblind people, and therefore you have, for example, instances where people might be put into older people's services rather than addressing their specific needs.
Okay, and is any of the members of the committee have any specific questions? I do take on board the points that, Jamie and, Ken have said. This comes on the back of our UC evidence of our last meeting where we were talking about condition-specific degenerative and long-term conditions being affected by the work capability assessment in particular. And I think we need to flag this up to the UK government about the fact, as Ken pointed out, people who are not going to improve or be put through the trauma of these tests continually. I think it's something we need to make sure that we're asking the pertinent questions about. But in terms of any support via social services or health boards, I mean, I think it would be legitimate to ask the Scottish Government if they could respond in terms of their awareness of that situation and what they might be able to do in terms of communication budgets rather than finding the money from care budgets or what have you, which might be their responsibility. So I think there's two lines of questioning we need to pursue there, and it would be useful to get responses back to that. If members have got other ideas that we need to...
Yeah, I agree with that. I do think we should maybe make our colleagues on the I don't know if it's the Health and Sport Committee, but the relevant committee. I think it probably would be them, but they might want to...
Yeah, I think that was a fair point as well, Jamie. If we did that, then we're informing one of the other committees who might be looking at this or have it in the remit for the future. Anything else? Okay. Well, with that, then I'll close the meeting to the public so that we can go into our private session.